it's overwhelming, but it's also our jobs.
Mm-hmm. Our job is only going to get harder.
It's worrisome.
This is something that's unprecedented.
Now is not the time to be a cowboy. No one has anything to prove. We're all in this together.
Welcome to Reporting from the Frontline of the Pandemic. I'm Natalie Clydesdale, and I'm here with Maggie Smolka, a morning anchor and reporter for WTAJ in Altoona, Pennsylvania.
My first question is, how have you had to adjust the way that you work throughout the coronavirus?
So a lot of changes have taken place, of course. Everybody's lives are kind of changing right now, and we're dealing with what everybody's calling this new normal and new way of doing things. And that, you know, directly impacts us in the news world. So at the start of all of this, what was kind of going on was I'm the morning anchor and I also report. So when we were doing our shows, we kind of had to figure out a way to social distance ourselves because we were telling people, hey, you need to social distance. You need to practice these good habits. So we need to show them on air as well. So we started to do, where my co-anchor was kind of doing live remotes from home. And we were kind of going back and forth in double boxes where he was anchoring from home and I was still anchoring from the studio. And then we kind of switched things around and we decided to kind of break up how we were doing things. So 3 days a week, he'll be doing the shows in the mornings. And then I do the second end of the week in the mornings. And then I also anchor the weekends as well. So it's this whole shift in schedule because we have to practice these social distancing habits. And the whole reason behind it is because we didn't want to all be in the studio together at one time. And we wanted to make sure that we were not all in the station at once, because if somebody did get sick, then we needed to have that person who was able to kind of fill in on the desk. So it's basically just keeping our distance from one another, knowing that things will go back to normal, that they'll go back to the same eventually. But right now we're just kind of adjusting to a new way of doing things. And that's in the studio. There's also a bunch of different things that we're doing out in the field as well. I don't know if you want me to continue with kind of the reporting aspect of it, because that's kind of the anchoring side of it. So that one is a fun one. And I think that that's probably the more difficult changes that we've had to make. We have to wear a mask 24/7 when we're outside. We have to have a mask on all times, which kind of makes it hard when you're looking in like the viewfinder and things like that. Just like little things that you really wouldn't think of. It's like this mask is kind of, you know, getting in the way of filming and everything. But you kind of adapt to those changes. No lav mics. We have to either use basically like a microphone stand, or we use like a pole that we have that were specially ordered for the station, where we'll hold them out and the microphones will be 6 feet apart between you and your interview subject. And just making sure that we're not getting, you know, too close to interview subjects, too close to the stories that we're shooting, keeping our distance, you know, using that Zoom because we don't want to get too close to the people who are out and about. So it's really a whole different way of doing things. When we are out in the field, those are the precautions that we take, but a lot of the interviews are taking place via Zoom, via FaceTime, which is, for me anyway, was really, really interesting because I like to have that human connection, that human interaction when I'm going and meeting a person. And so seeing them virtually was just a really different way of doing things. So it just kind of depends, because a lot of people right now don't really want to, you know, meet up in person. They would feel more comfortable doing a FaceTime interview or a Zoom interview because that's kind of what they're comfortable with right now. So we're really adapting to our viewers' needs and what they feel most comfortable with.
Mm-hmm. How has it been finding stories?
That's actually been very easy, believe it or not. There's a lot of, I like to do more feature type pieces. I have like a segment called Maggie's Moments where I kind of feature the good within the community. So I've been finding a lot of people reaching out because they want to hear the good stories that are taking place in the world right now. So So they want to hear about, you know, those birthday parades that are driving by. Or I did one where a photographer was going out for free and staying in his truck, taking photographs from his car just to spread some cheer and positivity. And he got people, you know, dressed zombies for the zombie apocalypse, and people, you know, paying tribute to sports that they never got to play for the rest of the year. Just really kind of creative, unique photos that he was able to grab. And those are the stories that people are really flocking to right now on social media, because they want to see the good in humanity and they want to see something positive, and that will make them smile right now. But, you know, besides the positive stories, you know, obviously our job as journalists are also to get the news out there about the numbers that are taking place, the healthcare workers that are on the front lines, the nurses, the doctors, the grocery store workers, kind of, you know, highlighting everything that they're going through as well. So it's really a combination of, you know, this, you know, good stories, but also you have to get the news out there as well.
What's been the hardest part of covering this pandemic for you?
I think at first was adapting to these changes. You know, the morning show, we have a lot of fun in the mornings. We, you know, like to talk a lot and have fun and chat. And then just kind of taking, you know, what we're used to having, a double anchor show. And then, of course, our meteorologist will be at the desk with us as well, kind of talking and things like that, to a single anchor show was a huge adjustment for us. And we're still kind of adjusting to that. And then, you know, with viewers too, they reach out, you know, is everything okay? Because they don't quite understand, you know, the changes that are taking place. So we kind of have to explain to them everything that we're going through and everything that we're kind of doing in order to stay safe. But I think that adapting to those changes at first was definitely the hardest part. And then I think the other thing is just kind of realizing that, you know, we're going through everything that everybody else is going through as well. And so it's kind of keeping that mental state. And also, you know, I have to work through this state. Because it's tough right now, and you know, you're not allowed to see friends. You know, you're not really allowed to see many people other than the people that, you know, you work with in the station, which is, you know, dwindled down to maybe, you know, three or four people in here at a time. And everything is kind of changing. And so you kind of have to realize that, you know, okay, I have to get through this. I have to, you know, deal with these changes, and I just have to kind of, you know, go with the way that everything's going. But I think that that would probably be the hardest.
What are some ways that you deal with that stress of not being able to see your friends and your coworkers and have all that interaction that you're used to?
I think the most important thing is at the beginning of all of this, when this was all, we were realizing that this is a huge deal. This is something that, you know, is a once in a lifetime type of thing in our careers that we're covering. And we have that responsibility to really cover it and tell our viewers what they need to know and what they are going to expect, what we're, you know, going through and what they have to do. You know, it consumed me for so long. And I was 24/7 just thinking about the coronavirus. When I wasn't at work, I was reading an article about it, or I was talking to, you know, my friends and family about, you know, different things, aspects wise of, you know, the different angles that we were covering, or, you know, what if we did this? What if we did that? And I think that the most important thing is that you just have to decompress. You have to watch a show on Netflix. You have to just kind of realize that this can't consume my life. Yes, I have the responsibility to report and do all of this. And, you know, I work, you know, 12, 14 hour days most of these days, but you know, those 10 hours where I'm at home by myself, you just kind of have to decompress and just kind of leave it at work. But I think that that's, you know, the most important thing, just having your me time, whether it's a show. I really love coloring, so I'll like color something, or if you like to cook or bake, just finding something that kind of gets your mind off of it.
Yeah, so I've been seeing on social media and just hearing that people are blaming the media for blowing the coronavirus out of proportion and saying that they're the reason for all of this. What is your response to that?
Yeah, that's tough. You know, I think that we oftentimes get some of the blame in the media because we're the ones who people are oftentimes hearing from it first. And some of the stuff that we're reporting is really tough and it's really hard to understand. And it's hard to think like we're reporting for these people, you know, the governor saying that, you know, you can't go out. The governor saying that, you know, we've seen an increase in deaths. We've seen an increase in social media mandates or social distancing mandates still have to stay in place. And so a lot of the times it's things that we don't necessarily want to report, but we have to report. And it's things that people don't necessarily want to hear, but they're getting that news from us firsthand. And I think that the biggest thing to realize is that everybody's a little bit frustrated right now. We're all kind of dealing with you know, different things that we've never dealt with before. And it's their kind of way of just, I guess, almost trying to come to terms, trying to cope with it. And so while it is, you know, frustrating at times because we're just doing our job, we also have to realize that everybody's human and everybody kind of goes through things the same way. So you kind of have to just ignore those comments and just keep on doing your job, keep on doing the best, you know, reporting that you can, and just kind of go from there. Because if you do your best, then there's nothing else you can really ask for.
Yeah. So earlier you talked about how you have to kind of do a feel-good story just to break up all of the negativity that's going on. What has been the best or your favorite feel-good story that you've done?
I talked about it earlier, but I think that my favorite story through this so far has been the one that I did with the photographer. He was a great character. And everybody who I came in contact with that day was so happy that we were sharing their story, that we were, you know, telling the good in the community and telling the positive in the community, that it just made everyone kind of feel good. And then in return, it did really well on social media as well. So it got shared for other people to see and that type of thing. So I think that was probably my favorite story that I've done this period.
Yeah, that sounds awesome. So kind of switching gears here, what advice do you have for anyone looking to get into the broadcast journalism industry?
Just in general?
Yeah, in general.
I think that you really have to have a passion for it. And I think that if you have a passion for it and you love telling stories and you love being able to connect with people and then share their stories in return, then do it. You will work long hours, you will work long days, but it doesn't even feel like it if you really, really love it. You know, I'll sometimes look at the clock, like I got in at 4 o'clock this morning and it's, you know, 4 p.m. now, but it doesn't even feel like it. Like the day went so quick because you're doing something that you honestly enjoy and that you honestly love. I think a lot of the time, you know, people will kind of come into the industry working it for maybe a couple months and realize that it's not for them. And I think it's because they're lacking that passion for that storytelling. And I think that you just really have to kind of have the passion for it. If you have it, do it and don't look back. Just keep with it.
Is there a piece of advice that you wish someone told you when you were first starting out?
Piece of advice. Let me think here. You know, I think it's always something kind of that you realize going into it, but I mean, it's a lot of hard work. And I don't think that, you know, you're going out in school and you're shooting your own pieces and you're working really, really hard on a story, but you essentially have a week to complete that package. When you get into the real world, it is that day turnaround. And you're working quickly, you're working efficiently, and most of the times you're working on your own. So it's really just being able to multitask and realizing that this job requires a lot of work and realizing that some days you're going to make something that you're so proud of. And then other days you're going to make something because you needed to make air and you had, you know, a half an hour to put a breaking news package together. And you just really worked really quickly and really efficiently and got it on the air. And those days are okay. And I think really starting out in the career, I think that a lot of the times, I mean, myself included, if you make a mistake, you're really hard on yourself. I think that those should be taken as growing opportunities. And it's just a matter of, okay, I made this mistake, but I'm going to learn from it and I'm not going to do it again. And then just kind of the job description in general, I think story ideas are so important. Knowing who you're going to interview, knowing what you're going to get, going into the story, that is so important because you have an idea of, this is how I want to tell my story. This is who I want to get. This is the video I want to get. And you have that idea going into it, knowing that it could change, but you pretty much know what you're going to expect.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, is there anything else that you want to add about journalism or about the coronavirus? Is there anything that I missed?
Let me think here. I don't know. I encourage, you know, any person who is looking to get into the industry to do it, to try it out, because I really do think that it is such an important job. And I know, you know, nowadays, you know, you do get, you know, the news media, the fake news and all of that. But at the end of the day, your job is so important and it's so worth it that it kind of, you know, washes all of those things away.
Yeah. Well, thank you for taking the time to talk to me. And thank you for all the work you're doing to keep us informed and safe.
Absolutely.
And thank all of you for watching this episode of Reporting from the Frontline of the Pandemic. I've been talking with Maggie Smolka, a morning anchor and reporter at WTAJ in Altoona, Pennsylvania. I'm Natalie Clydesdale.